So this is kind of where the PowerPoint notes from the last lecture stopped. We had derived the conservation of mass equation. There's another name for that. What's another name for conservation of mass? Mass equation. Continuity equation, right? So we had derived the continuity equation. That's here. But it has a, ultimately, we want to get the thing in terms of pressure, and we want to solve for pressure. And so we use Darcy's law, sort of the fundamental law of petroleum engineering. We substitute that into the continuity equation to get this modified form. Okay, but that we're still not where we need to be because we have density on the right-hand side still. We make the assumption that the fluid and the rock are isotropic and homogeneous, right? So what does homogeneous mean? Yeah, so it doesn't, it's not spatially varying, right? What does isotropic mean? It's the same in every direction. It's infinite planes of symmetry, right? So there was a question this morning, you know, can you have a material that's anisotropic but homogeneous? Can you? Yeah, of course. So if you had a, if you had an anisotropic material, your permeability would then be in 2D or 3D. It would be in some, you know, in 3D it would be some matrix, right? So you'd have independent permeabilities for every direction. And in general, the off diagonals are not zero either. But there's always some sort of coordinate system that you can rotate it into, such that you'd have a diagonal permeability like that. And so an example where, you know, if you had a 2D domain, and say you had an injector here, if you had some anisotropy, you could have a permeability. Well, I guess just for comparison, if it was isotropic, if it's completely isotropic, you're going to get diffusing concentrations that just diffuse out radially, right, in a uniform way. But if you had some anisotropy, you could get diffusing concentrations that were sort of elliptic like this because the fluid has a preference to flow in that direction. Right? Now, if it's homogeneous, it means if I move over to another place in the reservoir, there's not any spatial variability, so I'd get the same diffusing concentration, profiles of diffusing concentration. The fluid still has a preference to move in that direction. So that would be an example of a case where you have a homogeneous but anisotropic permeability. But if it's homogeneous and isotropic, we can move it outside. Really the one that matters is that if it's homogeneous. If it's homogeneous, I can move it outside of this derivative. Right? It's not spatially varying. So then we introduced the formation volume factor. Right. So we use the formation volume factor because why? We want to solve these equations in the reservoir, right? We want to solve the fluid mechanics in the reservoir. But typically all of our material properties are gathered in the laboratory at standard conditions, right? So in the reservoir is a higher pressure than there is in the laboratory, right, where we do the, so all of our experimental properties are typically at standard conditions. And so we introduce the reservoir, the formation volume factor is a simple way to use as inputs to our model standard condition values, yet still get the accurate results for flow in the reservoir. Okay. And so you know, it's the ratio of the density in the standard conditions to the ratio of the density under reservoir conditions. And typically, or not typically, but for oil, that's always going to be greater than one. For gas, it's going to be much less than one. And for water, it's going to be on the order of one. So a lot of times if we're talking about just single phase flow in water, like a reservoir, an aquifer, then we're just, you won't see the formation volume factor there because it's just one. So if we introduce that now, so again, the density that's in the continuity equation, we want to solve the continuity equation in the reservoir. So the density that appears in that equation is the density in the reservoir conditions, okay? So that's what that first statement says, that the density in the equation is the density in the reservoir, right? And so then we're going to go ahead and make that substitution, followed by the immediate substitution that the density in the reservoir is the density under standard conditions over the formation volume factor. And then we plug that into the equations, then we just begin some manipulation. So we use the product rule on the left-hand side of the equation and the train rule on the left-hand side of the equation to get this final sort of expansion here. And then we use the chain rule and the product rule on the right-hand side of the equation to the time derivative term. We get this. And then what we do is just a little trick, because what we end up with, is something that looks like the rock, the fluid compressibility, and something that looks like the rock compressibility, but they're not quite. So what we do is just multiply the equation by 1. Right? I can multiply the equation by 1, and it doesn't change the equation, right? So I'm going to multiply every term in the equation by 1. It's just right here, my 1 is going to take a special form. It's going to be phi over phi, right? And then I'm going to multiply the equation by 1 again. It's just here, I'm going to multiply by bw over bw. And then what you'll see is that I have a bw in both denominators, and I have a phi in both numerators. And so I can pull them outside the equation, and that's what you get here. So I pull those outside the equation. That gives that term, you know, factor it out. Not outside the equation, outside the parentheses, right? I factor it out. And what's left behind is exactly the fluid compressibility and the rock compressibility. So then if we just define the total compressibility as the rock plus the fluid, then we can replace this whole, what everything inside this bracket right there just becomes the total compressibility. So that's what the right-hand side looks like. Then the last assumption we make is we say that, well, if the fluid compressibility is small, then we can neglect that term. But there's something else there, too, that makes this a very valid assumption, in that the pressure gradient, you have the pressure gradient squared there, right? Well, the pressure gradient in the reservoir, I mean, a far, far away from sinks or sources, far away from wells, essentially, there's not steep pressure gradients in the reservoir, right? They're shallow. When I say steep or shallow, I mean big or small. Like, there's not large pressure gradients in the reservoir. There's small pressure gradients. So, you know, I have a small number, a small pressure gradient squared times a small number. You know, a small number squared times a small number is a small number. Right? And so that's a pretty good approximation. And that leaves us with the final form of the pressure diffusivity equation. And I don't think I did this in the notes previously, but there's one sort of last substitution or definition we make here, and that is we define the mobility. Right? So the mobility are all the parameters, you know, so if you look at the difference between alpha, you know, alpha has, which is the diffusivity constant, alpha has a phi in it. Well, phi is like a parameter of the rock, right? Phi is the porosity. So it's completely sort of a function of the rock, right? Whereas the other ones, the mobility, the parameters in the mobility, that's the permeability, the viscosity, the formation volume factor, those are all parameters of sort of fluid flow. Right? So, I mean, technically, the permeability is also a function of the rock, but it's a function of a certain fluid, like a fluid flowing in the rock. Right? And so, so with that, then, we can... Just in this source term, we have because we've divided the mass. You know, this was m tilde here, but because we've divided it by the mass, then you get like a flow rate. Instead of a mass flow rate, you get a volumetric flow rate. Okay, and that's what QSC is. So QSC is a volumetric flow rate that would come from a source or a sink, right? So a well, and it's divided by the mobility in the final form of the equation. So this is the final form. The pressure diffusivity equation under the assumption of homogeneous material properties and isentropy. Right? And so then if there's no sources or sinks, no wells, this term goes away, And you're left with the final equation, which is often called in the literature the heat equation. So we call it the pressure diffusivity equation in petroleum engineering, but more often than not in math textbooks and in other fields in mechanical engineering or whatnot, you're going to call this the heat equation because it governs conductive heat transport. Right? So if I just replace the P with a T, and then this becomes the thermal conductivity. And then I can model heat transport with the same equation. So everything we did there was in basically 1D Cartesian coordinates, 1D. Right? At the top there, you get the general diffusivity equation. Okay, and in that case, it's general. It's still general, but only under the assumptions of isotropy and homogeneous. Because this Laplace operator, so if I say the Laplacian, that's, you know, this del squared is a Laplacian of P, well, that's equivalent to the divergence of the gradient of P. But if this only works if I can pull, you know, because Darcy's law is K over mu grad P, but in general, in two and three dimensions, K is a tensor, right? If it's anisotropic. So there would be a tensor K here over P. Over mu, right? And so in that, and then K could also be a function of X, right? So it's only under these conditions, isotropy and homogeneity, that that equation holds. Because alpha is a scalar, right? If K was a tensor, I couldn't divide by it. Right? You can't divide, you know, when I say tensor, in this example, it just means, you guys probably don't know what a tensor is, right? But a matrix, right? It's a matrix. If K is a matrix, I can't divide by it. You can take the inverse, but you can't divide by a matrix. So I remember alpha has K embedded in it. Okay, so that's the general equation. If we expand it out in 2D, you get this guy. Now there's an assumption embedded in that, and that is that we've arranged our two-dimensional reservoir such that gravity doesn't matter. Right. So in a sense, it means we're sort of looking down on the reservoir. Because you can take a slice of the reservoir in 2D in two ways, right? You can look down on it, or you can look at the side of it. If you look at the side of it, you got to include gravity. In 3D, we have this equation, and notice that this P in the 2D equation has been replaced by phi. And what phi is like, it's like a potential that includes gravity. So it'd be P minus rho G Z. Right? Because in 3D, there's no way to avoid gravity. I can never take a slice of a 3D reservoir and not have gravity. And we may choose to ignore it, but in general, it has to be there in the equation.